Good morning. My name is Jerry, and this is my wife, Eileen.
Hi.
And we thank you for joining us for this online worship service today. Now, before we get started, we'd like to remind you to take a candle and light it.
This is to remind us of the presence of Jesus with us. Today is Communion Sunday, so you'll want to have some bread or a roll of some crackers with you, and also get some juice or water. Have your Bible ready to follow along with the scriptures.
Let's get ready to sing, pray, and hear God's word today.
Bye.
Bye.
Good morning, and welcome to this online worship service this morning. This is the First United Methodist Church of St. Cloud, and my name is Pastor Kathy Thacker. We are so happy to have you with us online participating in worship today. And it is our hope and prayer that as you worship with us, you will know God's presence with you, and you will feel his love for you. Psalm 126, verses 1 through 3 says, "When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, 'The Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us,' and we rejoiced." Please join our choir this morning in singing, "Change My Heart, O Lord." This morning, as we continue in our worship, we come to our time of prayer, and we ask that you would be mindful and remember those who have suffered from the devastation of the fires in California and hurricanes in Louisiana and Texas. So we will remember them as we go to God in prayer this morning. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for this time of worship. As we gather together online, be present with us. We know you know every single person watching and participating in worship today. We know you know the gifts you've given to each and every one of us. Help us, Lord, to use those gifts, to share your love and to serve your people, and give us joy. Help us to be your witnesses in the world, to be your instruments for peace. And during these times of uncertainties with the coronavirus pandemic, natural disasters, we pray for those in the paths of storms. We pray for recovery. For those who have lost homes and businesses, we pray for your comfort and peace for those who have lost loved ones. And we lift up and we ask that you would be with all first responders today. Protect them and watch over them. And we pray most of all for an end to racism and violence in our world, that people would love one another as you have first loved us. And this morning we come to confess that we have not done your will this week. We have not been obedient to your word. And please forgive us today. Help us to be more obedient. Help us to be good Samaritans and to be kind and gentle with our neighbors. Help us to be in mission each and every day. We thank you for your grace and mercy in our lives, and most of all for Jesus Christ, who came to earth, who gave his life, who rose again to give us eternal life. And this morning we pray together in the powerful and precious name of Jesus as we pray the words he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Samaritan. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And Jesus replied, a man is going down to Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed to the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place, saw him and passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. And he went to him and bandaged his wounds, and having poured oil and wine on them, and then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever you spend. Which of these do you think is a neighbor to the man who fell in the hands of the robbers? And he said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. The word of God for the people of God. Glory be to God.
So we begin a new series today called A Disciple's Heart, based on the book by Reverend Jim Harnish. And we hope that you will commit to being in worship online or in person when we begin in-person worship every Sunday during this series. That will be the best way that you can get the best benefit from this series. And that would be a good spiritual discipline for you. And so what is a spiritual discipline? It is a practice, a way of being where we draw closer to God. That could be in worship, Bible study, daily Bible reading, celebrating Holy Communion, being in a small group with other Christians, giving, helping, serving. So if I were to ask you today, how is your heart? What would you say? Would you say your heart is angry or bitter or hurting? Or would you say it is full to overflowing, joyful and happy? The writer of Proverbs tells us this to guard our hearts. He says, keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. We are to protect our hearts and to tend to them. John Wesley was the founder of Methodism, and he was an Anglican priest, and he felt called to go to Georgia to evangelize the heathens. He and his brother Charles traveled over, and the mission was a failure. And John Wesley, instead of converting a lot of people, went home to England hurting and discouraged. However, on the way back on the ship, there were Moravians on the ship. These were German Christians, pietists, and the ship encountered a terrible storm. And this storm was so bad that they felt the ship was going to be lost as well as their own lives. But what John Wesley observed was that the Moravians were praying, they were singing hymns, and they showed no fear of death. And this touched him, and this resonated with him, this example of faith. So much so that when they returned to England, they were spared, their lives were spared, that he began to attend Moravian meetings on Aldersgate Street. And one night on May the 24th, 1738, while he was at a Moravian meeting, one was reading the preface to the book of Romans about the heart change. And John Wesley felt his heart was changed. He called it strangely warmed, that he did trust in Christ for his own salvation. So John Wesley had been an Anglican priest for 13 years when this occurred, but he began to focus then on the heart, and this changed his life. He went on to become the founder of Methodism, and this religion was known for the methods or the methodical ways of doing things and the emphasis on the heart. So in our study, we're going to focus on the Wesleyan view of scriptures and how we live our lives. So how is it with your heart today? Is it loving and kind or bitter and angry? I want to read to you these words from Charles Wesley's hymn, "Oh, for a heart to praise my God." Oh, for a heart to praise my God, a heart from sin set free, a heart in every thought renewed and full of love divine, perfect and right and pure and good, a copy, Lord, of thine. So we want to look briefly at five stages of growth in our faith journey. In 1 Thessalonians 4:3, we read this, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification." Sanctification is the process by which we grow, the grace of God in our lives helping us to grow in our relationship. It's a heart strangely warm. That's the starting place of the journey. And as we journey, we go through stages. So what is a disciple of Jesus Christ? How do we define that? One might say a disciple is a follower of Jesus Christ, or someone who is growing and trying to be like Jesus. The main thing for us to remember that's very important is that no one journey is the right or only way to journey with Christ. My journey will be different from yours. Yours will be different from mine. And so we give each other grace. And isn't it wonderful to know that God gives us this journey, works in our lives, helps us along in different ways, or it would be boring, all the same. No one right way. So God works in our hearts in many different ways, and one size does not fit all. So let's remember that. So there are five stages of growth. The first is called ignoring or strangers to Jesus. People might say things like, "Well, I don't know if I believe in God," or "I believe in God, but I don't really think I need to be in a church or in a faith community." These folks are strangers to the church. The next stage could be called seeking or exploring. This person might say that their faith is not a significant part of their life. "I believe in God, but I'm not sure maybe about other aspects, about Christ, whether he is also Son of God, or I don't believe in the church. I don't know if I need the church." These people we call acquaintances or seekers, and they may be trying to imitate or emulate a follower of Jesus Christ, someone that they know. There's a story about a little girl, and she's watching her mommy get ready for a dinner party. Mommy's cooking, cleaning, busy, setting the table. Everything is just right, and that night they sit down at the dinner table, and so mommy suggests to her daughter Elizabeth, "Elizabeth, why don't you say the blessing tonight?" And Elizabeth says, "Oh, mommy, I don't know what to say." And so her mom says, "Well, just say something you've heard me say." So Elizabeth says, "Okay." And so they bow their heads, and Elizabeth says, "Dear God, what on earth was I thinking inviting all these people for dinner?" Sometimes that's what happens when we imitate another. The third stage is called getting started. This person is ready to say yes to Christ, to receive Christ into their hearts for the very first time. We call these people friends in Christ. They might say, "I believe in Christ and I'm working on what it means to follow him," or "I am participating in the life of the church." Years ago, in another church, we were having vacation Bible school. It was the end of the week, and so we invited the children who attended to say yes to Jesus, to invite Jesus into their hearts for the very first time. And when they did, we took finger paint, put on their hand, and made handprints, and then we wrote their name on the poster. We had a big poster. so that people could see, so that they could see that this was a wonderful decision that they had made. One little girl named Morgan said she was saying yes to Jesus, put her handprint on the poster. And afterwards, her mommy said, "Morgan, you've said yes to Jesus before." And she says, "Oh, mommy, I always say yes to Jesus. I just wanted my handprint on that poster." I wish we were all like Morgan, saying yes to Jesus all the time. The fourth stage we can call going deeper. These folks we call good friends, and they are ready to say that their relationship with Jesus Christ makes a difference in how they live their lives. They make decisions on what Jesus says and how he lived his life. They're discovering how their lives can make God's love real for other people. So they want to do what Jesus did: show love, serve, sacrifice, help. The last stage is called centering, and Reverend Jim Harnish calls these people intimate friends. And they say things like, "Following Jesus is the most important part of my life." Another way is this sanctification, growing in grace. God's sanctifying grace is working in our lives to make us more and more like Jesus Christ. But the important thing to remember is these stages of the journey is that we focus on our own. We're not taking an inventory of where someone else is on the journey. As AA people say, we take our own inventory, not someone else's. And that's important. And the last thing this morning is God, the church, and family all have roles to play. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan. A lawyer stands up and tries to test Jesus. He says, "What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus asks him, "What is in the law?" And he says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your soul, with all your mind, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus says, "You have answered correctly. Ta-da, you get an A." But then the lawyer asks Jesus another question: "Who is my neighbor?" And Jesus then tells them the story of the Good Samaritan. The Good Samaritan was traveling along the road to Jericho, and he saw a man who had been beaten and left for dead. Now, previously, a priest had walked by, but he didn't stop to help. He went around on the other side. Again, a Levite, the lay leader of the church, walks on the other side and does not help. But the Samaritan stops to help the wounded man. He bandaged his wounds. He puts him on his donkey. He takes him to the innkeeper. Now, we need to know that Samaritans were considered half-breeds by the Jews. They looked down their noses at them. They actually hated them. And when traveling north from Jerusalem to Galilee, would go around Samaria to avoid encountering the Samaritans. But this Samaritan took good care of this gentleman. At the end of the story, Jesus asked the lawyer, "Which of these three was the neighbor to him who was beaten and robbed?" And the lawyer said, "He who showed mercy." Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." So who is our neighbor, we might ask? Here at First Church, we believe that our neighbors are the poor, the homeless, the people in need in our community. And we serve them, we show God's love for them with Bags of Love lunches and Elmer's Kitchen hot meals. We also go to the St. Cloud Food Pantry and help pack food for those who are finding themselves in need during this coronavirus time. And here at First Church, we also show our love for others by wearing masks. Wearing a mask protects another person, and it also protects me. and it also shows my love for neighbors. When our hearts are right with God, when we are overflowing with mercy and goodness and love for others, we participate in the transformation of the world by being Christ to others, by reaching out to our neighbors. Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." Amen and amen. We continue our worship with our gifts to God this morning. There are three ways that you can give today. The first is to go to the church's website homepage. On that page is a button that says Give Online. You can click on that button and follow the directions to give online securely. The second way is to make your check payable to FUMC St. Cloud and mail it to 1000 Ohio Avenue, St. Cloud, Florida, 34769. And the third way is through AutoPay in your checking account. You can designate a gift that can be automatically sent to the church on a regular basis. And again, we thank you for your faithful support of the mission and ministries here at First Church. We are not meeting in person, but we are continuing to be in ministry, serving at the St. Cloud Food Pantry, giving out bags of love. Our preschool kids are here throughout the week, and we hosted the COVID mobile testing unit this past week as people came to be tested for COVID. I want to thank all of our volunteers who helped us. Let's go to God in prayer this morning. Almighty God, we thank you for each and every gift received for the ministries of this church. Bless the gifts and bless those who give them. May our lives also be offered to you as a gift. Multiply these gifts of tithes and offerings to be used to help those in need, to relieve suffering, to bring healing and hope to people in the name of Jesus Christ. It is in his name we pray. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship his holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. Thank you.
thousand reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never. And my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
We celebrate a meal to remind us of what Jesus did for us when he gave his life for us. So I invite you, if you haven't already, to get some bread, a roll or a bun, and some juice, any kind of juice or water, to participate in Holy Communion. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to God, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper, he took the cup, gave thanks to God, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as holy and living sacrifices, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here today online and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. All glory and honor is yours now and forever. Amen. Now I invite you to take your bread and take a piece, the body of Christ given for you. the blood of Christ shed for you. We thank you, God, for this wonderful mystery. I invite you to join our closing hymn, Cry of My Heart. Please join in singing with the choir. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and minds forevermore. With the knowledge and love of God and His Son, Jesus Christ, the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, be with you now and forever. Amen. God bless you. See you next Sunday.